हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला। आई एम कोमल यादव, रिसर्च स्कॉलर ऑफ गलगोटियाज यूनिवर्सिटी अटैच्ड विद सीएफएसएल सीबीआई न्यू दिल्ली। इन टुडेज मॉड्यूल वी आर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट गनशॉट रेजिड्यू। हाउ कैन वी डिटरमाइन रेंज ऑफ फायरआर्म बाय जीएसआर एंड अबाउट द फायरआर्म इंजरीज। सो व्हाट इज जीएसआर? जीएसआर इज द गनशॉट रेजिड्यू। GSR is also known as FDR. FDR is the firearm discharge residue. GSR is the burnt, unburnt and semi-burnt particles of the primer, propellant, cartridge case and the bullet. GSR are produced when a cartridge is fired from the firearm. So how can GSR is formed? When we press the trigger, the firing pin of the firearm strikes the primer of a cartridge. The primer compound ignites, sending a flame into the cartridge case. Propellant in the cartridge case starts to burn, causing it to change from solid material to gas. This change creates a large pressure within the cartridge, which in turn forces the bullet down the barrel and down range. Pressure building behind the bullet decreases as the bullet exits the muzzle end of the firearm. When the bullet exits the muzzle, pressure behind it blows the gunshot residue out of the firearm's barrel with high velocity. The residues are expelled from the barrel in a roughly circular shaped pattern. Gunshot residue travels a certain distance after emitting muzzle to the barrel and leaves a pattern around the entry hole. Gunshot residue is mainly composed of two substances, which are propellant and the primer. Propellants are of three types. These are black powder, smokeless powder and semi-smokeless powder. Black powder is composed of three main particles. These are 15% charcoal, 10% sulfur and 75% potassium nitrate. When the black powder is ignited, it produced a lot of smoke. Second one is the smokeless powder. Smokeless powder contains nitroglycerin and nitrocellulose. These compounds are known as nitrates. Smokeless powder can be classified into three main categories. These are single base powder, double base powder and triple base powder. Single base powder includes nitrocellulose. Nitrocellulose is also known as cellulose hexanitrate as its main ingredient. Second one is the double base powder. Double base powder contains both nitrocellulose and nitroglycerin. Nitroglycerin is also known as glyceryl trinitrate as its base. Triple base powder contains black powder, smokeless powder and semi-smokeless powder. Now we are discussing about what is semi-smokeless powder. Semi-smokeless powder is composed of black powder and nitrocellulose. These are all about propellant. Next, we are discussing about what is primer and what are the components used in the primer. Primer are used to start the ignition process in cartridges and commonly contain lead stiffenate, barium nitrate and antimony sulfide compounds. So where the GSR is found, or what is the location of GSR? GSR is found on the hands and clothes of the person who fires a handgun, also on the face in shoulder arm firing, the articles around the target or the shooter, the intermediate target from the muzzle end to the target. Next, we are discussing about the examination and the evaluation of GSR, which helps to solve a number of problems. It helps to give the information about, has the given gun been fired or not? Has the given projectile or cartridge case been recently fired? Is the given wound a firearm injury? What was the firing range? Did the victim commit suicide or was it murder? Correct answer can expose a fake suicide. These GSR can be helped to investigate these type of crimes. It plays a major role in the investigation of crime. How can we collect the GSR from the scene of crime? There are basically two common methods which are used. One is swabbing. In swabbing, a cotton woolen ball or a clean cloth piece or a filter is dipped in organic solvent. Solvents such as acetone, ether, alcohol, and the site is swabbed. The swabs are collected and extracted. Second is the tape lifting. The tape is used to tap the side. The tape picks up both organic and inorganic constituent from the site. Next is the examination of GSR. When a firearm is discharged and bullet strikes a surface, gunshot residues are deposited particularly at close range. These residues may be reproducible and therefore have evidentiary values. Some residues are visible and others require chemical treatment in order to visualize them. The preliminary and the visual and microscopic examination of gunshot residue should be given first priority because subsequent chemical testing can dislodge residue or alter the appearance of physical effect. Residue should initially be observed and evaluated by unaided eye and with a low power magnification, that is 3x is to 30x. Stereo microscopic infrared imaging may be used to visualize heavy shoot on the dark and the bloody clothing. There are some chemical testing which are used to identify whether GSR is present or not. First one is modified grease test. The test is performed first on the exhibit because it will not interfere with later test or lead residues. The modified grease test is a test to detect the presence of nitrite residue. As described earlier, nitrite residue are a byproduct of the combustion of smokeless powder. When a firearm is discharged, nitrite particles are expelled from the muzzle end of the firearm and can be embedded in or deposited on the surface of the target. The modified grease test is the primary test used by the firearm examiners to determine a muzzle to the garment distance or the target distance. The modified grease test is performed by first treating a piece of desensitized photographic paper with a chemical mixture of sulfonylic acid in distilled water and alpha naphthyl amine in methanol. Desensitized photographic paper is obtained by exposing the paper to a hyposolution. The photographic paper will no longer be light sensitive but be reactive to the presence of nitrite residue. The exhibit along or being processed is placed face down against a piece of treated photo paper with the bullet hole. Centered on the paper, the back of the exhibit being examined is then steam ironed with dilute acetic acid solution in iron instead of water. The acetic acid vapor will penetrate the exhibit and a reaction takes place between any nitrite residues on the exhibit and the chemicals contained in the photographic paper. The resulting reaction will appear as orange impacts on the piece of photographic paper. Next test is the diethoxamide test. It is also known as rubenic acid test, and it is a chemically specific chromophoric test for the presence of cuprous or copper bearing material. Copper jacketed bullets represent a considerable percentage of ammunition. Evidence in criminal cases. Basically, copper is used in the following types of ammunition. These are military and the sporting jacketed bullets, fabricating from gliding metal in 9 copper zinc alloy in ratio of 90:40, or commercial bronze, the ratio is of 90% copper is to 5% alloy of tin. Next is rimfire bullets coated or plated with copper or brass in ratio of 70:3, 70 is copper and the 30 is zinc alloy. Revolver bullets with copper jackets, nickel plated bullets, for example, silver tip bullets. The test identifies a bullet wipe or bullet splash caused by the copper bearing particulate in the form of bullet jacket fragments found around the perimeter of the bullet hole. While the test is not particularly useful for the distance determination, it can detect residue consistent with the discharge of firearm or the passage or the impact of a copper jacketed bullet. A dark gray green color indicates the presence of copper bearing material in bullet wipe. A blue pink color indicates the presence of nickel. For example, silver tipped bullets. Next test is for GSR is sodium rhodogenate test, which is commonly used in the forensic labs. This chemical test is designed to determine if lead residues are present on the exhibit. The sodium rhodogenate test is performed by spraying the exhibit with a weak solution of a mixture of sodium rhodogenate and the distilled water. This solution has a dark yellowish orange color. The exhibit is then sprayed with a buffer solution, which causes the background color to disappear. The sodium rhodogenate reacts with any lead that may be present and turns the lead a very bright pink color. The pink color is only an indication of the presence of lead residue, and to confirm the presence of lead residue, the area can be treated with a dilute hydrochloric acid solution. If pink color turns to blue, then the presence of lead is confirmed. Next, the instrument which is helpful in the detection of gunshot residue. Apart from the chemical test, we can detect gunshot residue by various instruments. The major methods for the detection of primer residues are analytical and qualitative analytical methods includes neutron activation analysis, NAA, as well as atomic absorption spectrophotometer, AAS, and inductively coupled plasma mass spectroscopy, that is ICP-MS, or scanning electron microscopy with energy dispersive analysis by X-ray detector, SAM-EDX, and automatic force microscopy, AFM, are used to identify the primer residue qualitatively. An X-ray analyzer can be beamed directly onto the particle visualized with SAM so that the energy dispersive spectra can be generated, giving the elemental composition of the particle. For these methods, sample must be obtained from the skin surface of a victim at the scene of the crime, and its delay in obtaining residues, movement, or washing of the body prior to autopsy will diminish or destroy gunshot residue. A rapid loss in numbers of GSR particles occurs from 1 to 3 hours post firearm discharge. So maximum recovery time is 1 to 48 hours, have been reported. When we get the negative result of GSR, it can be caused by when washing the hands after firing, or shooter may have been wearing gloves. How can we identify range of firing by GSR? Range of fire determination is based on the damage to the target and residue deposit on the target. The damage and the residue result from two factors, the projectile and the propellant. The projectile causes the entry hole and abrades the edge of the skin. At close range, up to 2 feet or you can say 60 centimeter in handgun and 6 feet approx 2 meters in a rifle range of a fire can be determined. Now we are going through bullet wounds. How can it cause? Gunshot residue emitted from the muzzle will travel out to distance of approximately 3 to 5 feet in most firearms, but in some cases it can travel even greater distance. At the 3 to 5 foot range, the gunshot residue may only consist of a few traces of the particles and make determining the firing distance difficult, if not possible. As the firearm gets closer to the target, the residue concentration increases and the actual size or the diameter of the pattern gets smaller. At around 18 to 24 inches, most firearm will start to deposit considerable concentration of gunshot residue or GSR that may or may not be visible to the eye. At distance of less than around 12 inches, heavy concentration of the visible gunshot residue will normally be deposited. When the muzzle of the firearm gets next to or is in contact with the target, hot gases escaping from the muzzle at high velocity would typically rip, tear, shred or melt and the material of the target. A very intense deposited of gunshot residue will be found around the margin of a contact or near contact entrance hole. There have actually been cases where a hard contact gunshot, or you can say muzzle pressed hard against the victim, caused the residue to blow through the wound track in the victim and be deposited around the inside of exit hole of the victim's clothing, entry wounds. The features vary depending on the range from which the weapon is fired. That is contact close, intermediate range or longer indeterminate range. Gunshot wound is controlled explosion and the bullet is accompanied from the gun by a jet of flame, a cloud of gas, burning and unburnt grains of gunpowder and shoot from burnt gunpowder. Entry wound may show the stigmata of the explosion to a lesser or greater extent. Next is contact wound. The muzzle is pressed against the skin. The heat of the discharge causes scorching or charring of the wound. The gases produced by the explosion of the cartridge enter, stretch and split the skin, producing a stellata or cuneiform tear. The tissue at the margin of the wound may contain shoot and the powder. Next is the close range, or you can say intermediate range. The wound is inflicted at less than arm's length. For example, it is less than 2 to 3 feet. The particles of partially burnt or unburnt powder from the muzzle or dry fern into the skin around the entrance wound, giving a stippled appearance that is called powder tattooing or powder burns. This area may be blackened by shoot. Shoot may be wiped off the skin, but powder tattooing cannot be wiped off. The bullet hole may be round or split, the latter being relatively common when there is underlying bone. Next is the long intermediate range. This range is less than 2 to 3 feet. The gun is too far from the skin for the product of the explosion to have any effect. Therefore, the appearance of the wound is due to entirely to the bullet. The wound is usually round but may be split by tail wag. If gun is fired from the extreme of its effective range, causing the bullet to lose its gyroscopic spin and start to tumble. Next is the marginal aberration, or you can say aberration collar, or you can say aberration ring. The margin of the entry wound in some close range and longer range injuries may be abraded, or marginal aberration, aberration collar or aberration ring. As the bullet inverts the skin and abrades the epidermis as it enters, the shape of this aberration may help in determining the trajectory. Grease ring. The inner edge of the aberration collar may be black due to grease or the lubricant oil and metal particles from the bullet. This grease, lubricant oil and the metal particles form the grease layer. After that, exit wounds. What are exit wounds? These show none to the stigmata, the explosion or the soiling seen in the entry wound. An exit wound may be the same size as the entry wound but may be smaller or larger depending upon the range. Type of weapon, type of bullet, the tissue being traversed by the bullet, etc. In a contact shoot, the entry wound is split by explosive gases and therefore usually larger than its corresponding exit wound. However, if the bullet comes out carrying bone, for example, a shoot to the skull, the exit wound may be larger than the entry. In a distant shoot, the exit wound may be same size or slightly smaller than the entry. In general, exit wounds tend to be split with irregular, inverted edge. As a rule, exit wounds do not show any aberration collar, but exceptionally this may be occur if the skin was pushed up and against a hard surface. For example, concrete wall or floor at the time the bullet exited. This is also known as a short exit wound. Distance estimation based on the following terms. These are scorching. Scorching is also known as singeing. This is caused by the incandescent gases as they emerge from the muzzle of the weapon. Distance not more than 1 inch. The barrel at a temperature of around 2000 degrees Celsius and decreases as it travels. Next is the blackening. Blackening is caused by the carbonaceous material in the discharge residue, mainly resulting from incomplete combustion of the propellant. Distance. In rifles, up to 10 inches or you can say 25 centimeter. In pistols, it is up to 5 inches, you can say 12.5 centimeter. The blackening is only a light surface coating and is very easily removed with water or by rubbing with a cloth. Weapon is within about 1 feet or you can say 12 inch of the skin surface. Next, On the basis of tattooing, we can identify the range of the firearm. The burnt or the semi-burnt powder particles may enter the epidermal layer of the skin, leaving an effect that is called tattooing. Distance in rifle, it is up to 48 inch or you can say 121 centimeter. In pistol, up to 30 inches or you can say 76 centimeter. The tattooing is permanent mark, not easily removed by washing or shaving. After that, that is metal fouling. The presence of small fragments of metal particles from the bullet on the gunshot wound. The distance up to is 16 feet or you can say 5 meters. Pistol entry wound through the eyebrow with adjacent powder tattooing features of wound based on distance. Rifled firearm wounds, contact wound. In case of rifled firearm wound, contact wound is the muzzle is with tight contact with the skin. Wound is circular and smaller. May be stellate shaped over the scalp. Muzzle imprint and abrasion with a star shaped laceration would come in close range firing. It forms a star shaped wound. Loose fibers of the fabric on the gunshot entry wound will turn outward due to gases expansion. Scorching, blackening of wound edge shoot within the tissue may be found. Usually is less. Backspatter. For example, blood is sucked up into the barrel of the weapon, not common, close range shoot wound. The distance is 1 to 3 inches in handgun and 12 to 18 inches in shoulder guns. Almost always circular in shape, edges are inverted, collar of abrasion, metal fouling is present. Burning effect is about a few centimeters. Tattooing and powder stippling around. Distance range wound. From less than 0.5 meter to several kilometers, entry wound appear alike. There is an abrasion collar around entry wound. Wound is inverted, ring of dirt or grease ring. A bullet striking sideways may produce a rectangular lacerate wound. Exit wound, inverted in shape. Secondary missiles generated within the body. If bullet is not seriously deformed in the body, the exit wound is classically of a stellate shape with triangular skin flaps. There may be a multiple exit wounds due to secondary missiles. Single bullet may produce multiple entry and exit wound. Multiple entry wounds are due to separate entrance wounds of jacket and core from the same bullet. Fragmentation of bullet and intermediate target may produce irregular entrance wound. Short exit wound shows abrasion around exit wound when a person standing against a wall or lying on the ground is fired. This will show the wound. So these type of firearm wounds we can identify the proper. So friends, you might learn a lot from the presentation. How can we determine the range of firing from the gunshot residue? What is GSR and the firearm injury? Thank you for watching this video.